Thank you. Thanks. So this building and this warehouse that you've come to visit today, for 40 years it's been the home of sporting goods in Canada. And 2 months ago I had the opportunity to buy the land and building and move our operations here. And so now we've got a staff of 12 that works out of this facility, and we're supplying Canadians with the top brands in sporting goods. And you probably know us best for lacrosse, hockey, and baseball gear. And I mentioned that because after the event, if you wanted to do a tour, come see me or any of the staff here, be happy to show you around. We're sitting on 5 acres of property and 65,000 square feet of warehouse space. It's a pretty cool spot to be here. They say the greatest currency is time, and I'm really honored that you're here to share your time with us. And in a minute, I'm going to introduce Dave Bidini, and I'll tell you a little bit about Dave. But first, on the format, Dave's going to come up here and interview Buck, and we'll have time at the end for some Q&A. So if you have a question, you know, save it to the end, but make sure you get it in. And then in the very end, we'll have an opportunity to come up here and do a photo op with Buck. And I have a book for everybody, Buck's latest book called Change Up, How to Make the Great Game of Baseball Even Better. And it'd be just great if you would take a copy of that book. Buck's willing to stay around and sign it and do a photo with you. If you do a picture with Buck, Scott's going to capture that, and we're going to email it to you right after the event. So I'm honored to have Buck here, and I was thinking about who the best person would be to interview Buck. And I've had the privilege of seeing Dave Bidini interview great athletes like Roberto Alomar and Doug Gilmore, and personally I think he's the best in the world at this kind of stuff. But that's just one of Dave's talents. He is also an author and musician. His band, he's a founding member of the Rio Statics, who you probably know. And he's the author of over 10 books, including Tropic of Hockey, On a Cold Road, Around the World in 57 and a Half Gigs, Home and Away, and a number of others. He's also, and this is kind of an interesting fact about Dave, he's the only person nominated for a Gemini, a Juno, a Genie, and also nominated for CBC's Canada Reads. So he's got a whole list of accomplishments, and I'm thrilled to have him here today. Ladies and gentlemen, Dave Bidini.
Thanks, Sean. I usually have to leave the room when they're listing my achievements, but that wasn't too painful. Thanks, Sean. Thanks a lot for coming. We're going to have a great time this afternoon. Some of you may know about Buck, but if you don't, I'll tell you a little bit about him. In many ways, he's the single most figure that's been woven into Blue Jays culture over the history of the team, both as a player, a manager, and a broadcaster. 17 years in the majors, played for both Kansas City, Milwaukee, and the Jays, started in 1969. Came to Toronto in 1981, where he joined the Jays. And really, his game matured along with the rest of a very young team in the 80s who peaked in 1985, winning the first ever division for the Blue Jays. A momentous moment, really, in Canadian sport, North American sport in a lot of ways, being an expansion team. That started in 1977 in the snow in April. I was there. My dad entered a contest to win tickets, and we got a chance to see the birth of the Blue Jays, which was an incredible thing for a kid who'd grown up loving baseball, but it had to cheer for a team that existed in other places. After retiring in 1986, Buck moved to broadcasting around the game. And because he's been broadcasting for a number of years now, he's really bared witness to some of the great and impactful moments in baseball over the last 30 years. He's really been at the shoulder of every significant moment in the game, so we can speak to that as well when we talk. He's an author of a few books, but his latest is called Change Up. It's right here. It's really great too. Change Up, How to Make the Great Game of Baseball Even Better, and I recommend, well, you're going to get a copy anyways. You're really going to like it. It's a great book. So please, welcome Buck Martinez. Sir?
Thank you, Dave.
My pleasure. Geez, we could start so many different places, but I was thinking on the drive here, W.P. Kinsella was a great Canadian author. We lost him last week. He wrote Shoeless Joe, Thrill of the Grass, The Iowa Baseball Confederacy, and Field of Dreams comes from the work of W.P. Kinsella, Shoeless Joe. And while reading the book, there's an incredible Field of Dreams moment here, and perhaps you can illuminate for us, even just logistically, how this happened, what your dad built in the back of your backyard growing up in Northern California, how he put together this diamond for you.
Yeah, I grew up in Redding, California. I was born in Redding in Northern California, about 160 miles north of Sacramento. My father was a telephone lineman, and he had access to old telephone poles, of course, and so you know what you do with old telephone poles, you make a backstop. And we had four boys in my family, and we lived in a neighborhood. It was a very young subdivision. We lived across the street in an older house, but the subdivision was brand new in the middle 50s, and there was a lot of kids there, so we would play ball. And my dad built the backstop. He made the telephone poles and chicken wire, and we had two by 12s on the bottom, so it looked like a regular baseball field. That's where I learned how to drive a truck. I was 10 years old, and I would drive the truck around the infield and drag the infield on 1948 Ford pickup. But we would play baseball literally every day. We would get every kid in the neighborhood. My mom would make sandwiches and bring Kool-Aid out for us at noon, and then we'd play until dark every single day. But that's where I learned to love the game of sport of baseball, and had so many friends that we shared in it. We'd pick up Coke bottles. We had over the left field fence, which is only about 150 feet away, there was a house that had asbestos shingles on it. And if you're familiar with asbestos shingles, they break very easily. So we had to get Coke bottles to buy shingles to replace the ones we broke. So it taught us a lot of good lessons playing baseball in their backyard. It was a great way to grow up.
Well, it's interesting. It resonates, I think, for Canadians, because our hockey mythology is based on the backyard rink, but you don't often hear of a backyard diamond. And here we are just up the road from Brantford, where, you know, Wayne Gretzky's backyard rink is almost like a mausoleum now in terms of the importance to Canadian sporting culture. So you're learning the game as a kid, and you know, you're cutting your teeth in the backyard, and then you're playing. I don't know whether they call it. Do they call it? What's the when you play Little League? It's called Little League.
Little League. Yeah. That's right. I started playing Little League when I was eight.
Okay, when you're 8 years old, parts of the book here take place in the minor leagues, which. You know, surely an unromantic life for a ball player, but also really, really evocative. You talk a lot about the people you meet and the players who've influenced you. Sliding into the minor leagues and becoming a minor league ball player, what were the revelations for you in terms of what it took to be a ball player, to come up through that and eventually emerge into the major?
Well, I was very fortunate. I played 3 years of high school baseball in California, which you can imagine is very competitive. But we were in a small community, not much bigger than St. George. It was a farming community, and we had a lot of dairy farms there, but most of the kids were farmers. The biggest part of our school was Future Farmers of America. It wasn't anything to do with baseball, but I played on a baseball team for 3 years. I didn't get drafted, and you remember, the draft started in 1965. So I graduated from high school in 66, didn't get drafted in that second draft. Went to junior college thinking I was just going to go play because I like to play. We ended up having everybody in our little, well, Sacramento wasn't a little town, but everybody we played against as kids decided to go to Sacramento City College together. We had seven guys off that team signed professionally, and we won the state championship 2 years in a row. But I signed after my freshman year with the Phillies. I'd never been on an airplane. I'd never been out of California. So I go to the municipal airport in Sacramento and get on a DC-6, and go to the back of the plane, sit down next to an older guy. He was 21. And I said, "Where are you going?" He says, "I'm going to Eugene to play baseball." I said, "Well, I'm going to Eugene to play baseball." He says, "Yeah, I just got sent down from Bakersfield in the California League to the rookie league in Eugene." And I said, "Well, that's pretty interesting." And I didn't know anything about professional baseball. So his name was Nick Van Loo, and Nick said, "I think we're going to have a real good team up here. We've got this great kid that just signed. He's a catcher, and he's going to sign and play for us." And I thought, well, what the hell am I going there for? If they already got a catcher, I'm not going to play. But in fact, the next day we had our first workout, and I went out to see this new catcher, and I couldn't find him. They were talking about me. So it worked out really well. But I had no aspirations of professional baseball. I just played because I loved it.
So did you feel the burden of pressure when you found out that you were the prized?
No, not at all. I wasn't smart enough to think of pressure. We just played. We played baseball because we loved it. And, you know, to backtrack just a little bit, I want to talk about W.P. Kinsella, because I met him several times, and I was a big admirer of his work. And when he wrote Field of Dreams, I thought that was the coolest thing in the world, because a father and a son sharing that great sport together. And when he came out on the field and said, you want to have a catch? And, you know, that's brought us all back to our childhood and the great love of the game you have, because you can bond through baseball. But as far as pressure, I was the most valuable player in my college season. I had a tremendous year, and I went up, and I remember I was slumping, and I was homesick. First time I've been away from home. I was in another state and living with guys I'd never met before, and there were even some Latin Americans that couldn't speak English, and everything was different for me. But I called my dad up one time, and I said, Dad, I don't think I can do this. I'm not hitting as well as I thought, and it's a lot harder than I thought. I think, you know, I just don't know if I can get through it. He says, well, what are you hitting? I said, I'm down to 324. But I, you know, I had hit so well in college, but I ended up almost winning a batting title my first year. That was with the Phillies. But yeah, there was no pressure at that time, because you were just playing for the love of the game. And you know what, something that you might not know is, when I first got to the major leagues, when I was 20 years old in 1969, my salary was $10,000. So there wasn't any pressure. I had to work in the off season.
And were there bonus babies at that time, or they didn't?
Yes, there were. There were bonus babies. I think, if you put everything together, I signed for about $45,000. I was a second round pick of the Phillies. At that time, there were two drafts. There was a January draft and a June draft. I was drafted in January in what they call a draft and follow. You draft the guy, and then you watch him play his college season, and then if you think he's worthy of signing, you sign him. And that's the first time I ever heard my father swear, when the scout came into my house to negotiate the contract. And we're hemming and hawing. He didn't know anything about baseball. I didn't know anything about baseball. And my dad, you know, Friday was payday, and we'd get a round steak on Friday. We thought that was a big deal. So my dad says, well, if we could get, you know, if we could get $25,000 out of this contract, I think we'd be really happy. That'd be a lot of money. My dad didn't make that much in a year. So the scout came in, and I took a deep breath, and my dad had said, if you ask for 40, we'll probably end up with 25. So I said, well, Mr. Bachman, I'd like to play for the Phillies, and I think I would sign for $45,000. He said, deal.
Nice.
And that's when he went out to get his typewriter to write the contract, and my father said, we screwed up. But it all worked out.
Did you have, in those days in the minors, did you have a mentor? Was there somebody who took you under your wing?
You know what, and I didn't play that long in the minors. Okay. I played for two seasons in the minors, a total of about 130 games. It was 1969. 1967, I signed. The Vietnam War was at its peak, and we all were eligible for the draft. So I didn't go to spring training. I stayed in school to keep my college eligibility up and to stay out of the draft. So I went from my college campus to the major leagues in my third professional season. So I signed in June, joined the Eugene team in June, and played 60 games my first year. The next year I went to Spartanburg, South Carolina in an A league and played 35 games. And I wasn't playing. I started in Spartanburg and I played 11 games. I hit 394 and drove in 11 runs in 11 games, and they promoted me to Tidewater, which was another league higher. And I sat on the bench. And I went to the manager and said, I need to play. I've been in school. He said, don't worry about it. We know what we're doing. Well, it was many years later I found out they were trying to hide me. so they didn't have to put me on the major league roster and take another spot on the roster. So they figured if I didn't play as a 19-year-old, nobody would draft me. Well, Pat Gillick, Joe Gordon, all these guys knew me from my college days, and I got drafted by the Phillies by Kansas City, actually by Pat Gillick in Houston. And we had that tie long ago. So Pat Gillick was the GM in Houston who drafted me and traded me to Kansas City. And that's how I got to the major league so quickly.
Could you tell us about your first major league at bat?
Yeah, first major league at bat. It was against Oakland in Kansas City in O'Ball Park. And I had just joined the team. I was a Rule 5 player, so they didn't expect me to play. I was just going to stay on the major, like Joe Biagini is now. He's a Rule 5 player. Nobody expected him to pitch, but he pitched so well, now he's one of their best pitchers. So I joined the team in June, worked out a few days, took batting practice, and the manager was Joe Gordon, a Hall of Fame second baseman. And all of a sudden, I'm sitting in the bullpen in a doubleheader against Oakland, not expecting to play, and the phone rings, and we were getting killed. And Mo Drabowski, our closer, the great closer for so many years, said, "Hey, rookie, go down there and hit a home run." So I went down, and my first at-bat was against Chuck Dobson of the Oakland A's, and I hit a fly ball to the wall in center field and made my first out. Then in the second game of the doubleheader, I got my first big league hit. Same conversation. "Hey, rookie, go down there and hit a home run." And I got a base hit off Blue Moon Odom right up the middle. And it was incredible. You know, when I was so young, I didn't even appreciate it. But it was just playing baseball again. It was pretty cool.
Yeah. Obviously, people associate you with the Blue Jays. And coming to this team, as you did in 1981, you know, we're talking really the nascent era of Jays baseball. And even baseball in, certainly in Ontario, pro baseball in Ontario. We're new to the game. You know, I think Earl Weaver, might be Sparky Anderson, tells a story about coming back to the dugout and people giving him a hard time and he telling everybody to shut up and everybody falling silent because they did what they were told. And you talk about your wife Arlene almost educating or trying to instruct fans in terms of how. Perhaps could you contrast, and we just saw what happened in Seattle with the incredible excess of fans down there. Maybe compare that to the early days of Blue Jay baseball and what the atmosphere was like.
Everybody remembers the playoffs last year against Texas in that seventh inning when the place went bananas and it was a 57-minute inning and it was crazy. Well, when I first got here, and I'll back up a little bit, I had been released by the Brewers in May of 81. So I had 10 days to be traded or released or whatever. And about the 10th day, my wife gets a phone call. It's Pat Gillick and said, We have made a trade for Buck, and we want him to come to Toronto. Her question was, where do you have spring training? Because the Brewers trained in Arizona, and she hated it. And he said, Florida. And she went, yeah, we're going to Florida again. So anyway, I go to, you know, and it's late in my career. I'm, you know, probably at that time I was 32, and I'd played in Kansas City for 8 years, in Milwaukee for 3.5 years, and now I was going to Toronto. So I said, well, I guess this is it. My career's going to be over. I'll go to Toronto and that'll be it. So I went and it was cold. The first night I got there, it was freezing in May and rainy. And I thought, man, I've really hit rock bottom. So, you know, I wanted to know, you know, where all the Eskimos were and everything else. And you'd have to find where Toronto is on the map and all of that. But Pat Gillick told me, he said, we brought you here to teach the pitchers how to pitch and teach Ernie Witt how to catch. And we don't care what you do, just do that. And I figured I'd play a year and finish it out well. As you know, I played 6 years, and here I am. You can't get rid of me anymore. But it's been a wonderful run, and it was a cultural change, too, because like you say, Dave, in 81, they didn't sell beer at the ballpark. And that had a very negative effect on the audience. So my wife came from Milwaukee, which was the center of the beer world, and now they're drinking beer at the ballpark all the time, and all the Brewer fans are having a great time drinking beer and celebrating. And she got there, and it was like a whisper. It was the tennis clap and the golf clap, and isn't that nice? And she goes, what's wrong with you people? Let's cheer, they're winning.
Well, also fans at that point, having, you know, watched other teams all their lives, are just as excited to see the Yankees and the Red
Absolutely.
Sox come
more
to play.
Excited.
More excited.
They
than
have
to actually
better
see
players. They had a lot better players. They had recognizable names and all of that. So it was a growing period. Bobby Maddox was the first manager that I had, 1981. And then Bobby Cox came in 1982, and that's when everything started to change. Bobby Cox came from the Atlanta Braves. First year in spring training, he looked around and there was players everywhere. Pat Gillick had done such a great job of developing the farm system that there were players everywhere in our farm system. Guys, I didn't even know when I was a teammate of the major league team, and now I could see all these kids, and I'm going, you got Barfield and Bell and Mosby and Upshaw and Griffin and Garcia, and there were players everywhere. But Bobby Cox came in and just started that winning mentality, and he utilized the platoon system, and we grew into a very aggressive team.
That's one of the really interesting pieces of the book. You do you take time to take apart the anatomy of of team building. And you talk the talk about the Orioles, and you talk about the Royals, and you talk about the Jays, sort of then and now, Anthopoulos versus Pat Gillick. 81, 82, you know, 1983, the Jays had a competitive club, and then Tippi Martinez picks off three guys at first base. And 1984, the Tigers run away with it, and then the fruit ripens in 85. But not to get ahead of ourselves, and you talk a little bit about what Gillick assembled. Can you provide us a little bit of insight with the schematic of that club? And how, because you were at the ground level, you were seeing it come together. What are your memories of that?
Yeah, the genesis of the reason I wrote this book was I'm in the game every day, and I see so many great athletes who have skills far beyond anything that we had at that time, but there's not the attention made to fundamentals, throwing, catching, base running, sliding, all of the little nuances. Everybody wants to hit, just like all of you that are involved in kids' sports. First thing you want to do is hit. Nobody wants to play catch. Nobody wants to run the bases. And I'm sure it's the same in hockey and lacrosse and everything else. They want to score goals and hit and do all of that, but they don't want to do the fundamentals of learning how to skate and playing catch and learning how to hit the cutoff man and all that. Branch Rickey, who began years and years ago, had a football background. And when he got involved in baseball, he thought he could train baseball players like football players. Chalkboards, plays, do all of that stuff. Well, he was on the right track, but baseball is such a different game because there are no grid lines. There's no time clock. There's no constraints. So in baseball, it's a fluid game that you have to have athletes adjust to what's going on during that time. So Branch Rickey wanted to make a minor league system. He said, I'm going to groom my own players. I'm going to get athletes that are good athletes, they can run, they can hit, they can throw, they can do a lot of things. And all the owners at that time told him, you're crazy. All you got to do is buy players from minor league teams, and then you'll have your own team. But he said, they won't be my team. They won't be my kind of players. And he was right, of course. He built the Cardinals, he built the Dodgers, he built the Pirates into these lasting organizations that emphasize fundamentals. And it's not unlike business. When you have a foundation of solid work ethics, where you go to work every day and you enjoy what you do, then you have a core of satisfied people that are working for you and they are goal-oriented and you build a team. It's never been more challenging for a professional head coach or manager in this day and age to have a winning team because everybody's making a lot of money. The minimum salary in baseball is $500,000. The average salary is $4 million. And when you tell somebody, I want you to bunt that guy over to second, he's going, that doesn't translate to my contract. So you have to create this whole homegrown mentality. If you think about the 96 Yankees that started that core four group with Jeter and Posada and Mariano Rivera and Andy Pettit, they were all homegrown. They were playing with their friends. They were playing for one another. And that creates an attitude where nobody lets the other guy down. And it's just like in work and business, if you have a great team, everybody has to lift their game up to match the games of everyone else on their team.
Well, even from a fan's perspective too, you know, seeing George Bell debut as a Jay, you know, skinny little kid, and they're growing up to become this, you know, this MVP. I remember actually once coming across Fred McGriff at the corner of King and Parliament. And I recognized him because he was a, you know, prospect playing for the Jays, and he was lost. So I kind of tapped on the window, are you Fred McGriff yet? Yeah, I'm lost. So I gave him directions to where he had to go and stuff. But you got to know a player from when they were kids, and it was so really romantic as a fan to sort of see them grow. And then eventually, like the teams that you play on in 85, winning the division. So you're following them through their lives, really, as ball players in a way. For me as a fan, 1985 is epic in so many ways. You know, the roller coaster and ended up, you know, and beating the Yankees and going into Yankee Stadium and having Domasol Garcia hit Tony Fernandez in the stomach, the routine double player. It might have been the other way around, I'm not sure, but and then feeling that nausea, oh, we're going to lose to the Yankees, that's going to be it after having such a great year. But on a personal level, 1985, is it as epic in your imagination as it is for me as a Jays fan? Because it was really highs and lows, and maybe you can take us a little bit, escort us a little bit through that historic year.
Yeah, the 1985 team was a culmination of Pat Gillick putting together these kids that they got from other organizations. George Bell came from the Phillies, and Willie Upshaw came from the Yankees, and Lloyd Mosby was homegrown, but they all grew up together. And because of the fundamentals of Bobby Cox and Bobby Maddock and on-the-field drills and training, and the fact that there was so much competition because there were so many great players, we had guys competing, Domasol Garcia and Manny Lee and Alfredo Griffin, and they were all pushing each other because you've created this atmosphere of excellence. But the 85 team was a culmination. 83 was a very good team. Bobby Cox thought that was the best team he ever had, but we didn't have any relief pitching. The 84 team, the Tigers got off to 35-5 start, and we couldn't catch them. And then the 85 team, we started to put everything together. And, you know, it was bittersweet for me because I broke my leg in July of 85 in a play at home plate, and I had a collision. And that story is kind of an interesting one because it wasn't my day to play. And I played alternate days with Ernie Witt. He was a left-handed hitter and I was a right-handed hitter. So Bobby came to me that day at about 2 o'clock in the afternoon and said, "You're going to catch tonight." And I said, "Okay, why?" He said, "Because we're bringing up this kid to make his Blue Jays debut named Tom Filer, and I want you to catch him." I said, "Okay." And I was hitting about 160 at the time. I was hot. And so we play this game, and we're on the West Coast in July. Can't win a game. We've just been to Oakland, just been to Anaheim. Can't win a game. Runs are tough to come by, so they bring this pitcher up to start. And about fourth inning, there's a guy at third base, Jim Presley. And Jesse Barfield's in right, and there's a fly ball in. It's a scoreless game. He tags up. Jesse throws me the ball on the first base side of home plate. I dive back over home plate and tag him out before he gets to the plate. A double play ends the inning. So everybody's celebrating. Jesse Barfield's nice throw. And I said, "Jesse, next time, throw it on the other side of home plate so I don't have to move so much." The next inning, the situation presented itself. Phil Bradley was a base runner at second base. He played quarterback at the University of Missouri, and he was an option quarterback. So he used to flip the ball to James Wilder, who was a great running back in the NFL, and then he would block the defensive end. So he's barreling around third as I'm positioning myself to make this catch. The ball hit my glove. He hit my shoulder at the same time. My ankle stuck in the dirt. I broke my leg, dislocated my ankle, and tagged Phil Bradley out. And then in my fog, I sat up and I saw the base runner going from second to third, Gorman Thomas, and I threw it in that direction. And the ball went down the left field line. Now, George Bell's playing left field, and he wasn't known to be a great outfielder, but this was maybe the best throw he ever made. As Gorman Thomas is running around third, I scoot into position on the ground to make the catch. And I catch it a one hop and tag out Gorman Thomas. And that was a double play. But that ended my season. That's why it was bittersweet for me, because I watched him clinch without the ability to play. But that was a culmination of a lot of hard work and disappointment of 83, 84, and in 85 finally being able to win. It was a special time for baseball in Canada.
Well, and you know, you had to suffer through that play, one of the most spectacular plays that any of us have witnessed. But I remember when it happened and the fact that you got the outs, I remember thinking, maybe there's a little bit of magic almost here. I mean, you had to break your leg for it to happen, unfortunately, but it was such a...
You know what? It was such a good bunch of guys. I think everybody kind of rallied around that. They brought in Al Oliver right after that and Cliff Johnson, and everybody started to think, okay, this is going to be our year. They would win that game in the 14th inning. George Bell hit a grand slam in the 14th inning, and I was in the hospital, but they were celebrating.
Well, one of the nice notes in the book is how after your injury, you know, the coaches and Gillick and the staff are, you know, come to the hospital, and you can illuminate this better than I can, but that's not necessarily a given in professional sport. I have a friend who played for the Leafs, and he broke his leg at one point, and the coach came in, didn't even look at him, uttered an expletive, and then left the room. But the fact that they all came, and I mean, this leads me to my next question in terms of the fragility between a team that is successful and a team that doesn't win. It's such a, you know, it's like holding a bird in your hands. It either flies away or you crush it, right? Can you give us some insight in terms of what makes great teams great, maybe in relation to 85, but just in general?
Yeah, that's a great point, because they all came to my hospital room after I was put in a room. They put a cast on my leg and put me in traction, and I'm sitting up there, and it's about 2 in the morning. The entire coaching staff came in, and Bobby Maddock, who was the longtime advisor for the Blue Jays, said it was the greatest play they'd ever seen, and he had been in the game since the 30s. It was truly that feeling like we were family members and we wanted to fight for each other and we wanted to win for each other. And I think you don't really attain greatness until your entire team hates to lose. And I think that's the true mark of a championship team, when you hate to lose. Not so much that you want to win, but when you hate to lose, that's when you're really going to win. And I think that's what the Blue Jays learned last year, that they didn't want to lose anymore. When they all stepped up, and Tulowitzki and Price and all those guys came around, it put together a great surge.
A lot of the ways your career and really life has played out is charmed in a way. And I say that in relation to your retirement almost, where in the book you write about, oh, I guess I just suddenly realized I was retired. We don't know how.
We didn't have a tour to announce my retirement like David Ortiz.
Right. But it didn't seem like it was an episode where it was tearing you apart, or maybe I'm wrong, but did that seem to be, you were able to reconcile it fairly easily, or
I didn't do it by myself. Yeah. So in the 1986 season, I played the next year after I broke my leg. I missed the entire second half of the season, came back in spring training. Jimmy Williams was now the manager. Bobby Cox had left the Blue Jays after the 85 season, went to Atlanta to become the general manager. So I'm in spring training, and I'm at the end of my career. I'm 37 years old, and we play the season out. And Jimmy Williams comes to me on the final day of the season and says, "Can you stay around and come up to the office tomorrow? We'd like to talk to you." And obviously you're not going to offer me a contract extension, but I'll come up. So Jimmy Williams, Paul Beeston, Pat Gillick are all in Beeston's office. And they're sitting there, and Pat Gillick is very emotional, always tied to his players. I mean, he sees all of his players as his children. There's no doubt about it. So he's wringing his hands, and he's very nervous. And I don't know how to tell you this. You've been such a big part of this team. And I said, "Hey, Pat, I thought I was going to be here for a year. I was here 6 years. Everything was great. I appreciate everything, the opportunity." And Paul Beeston pipes in and says, he always calls me Albert. That's my middle name. He goes, "Albert, you want to do television?" I said, "No, I don't think so. I think I'm gonna play some more." And, you know, Jimmy Williams is saying, "Yeah, you've been a great member of our team, and we're sorry to see you go," and everything. So I go home and tell my wife the meeting. We've been released. We're not going to play anymore. But Beeston offered me the television job. And she says, "And what did you say?" I said, "No, I said, I think I'm going to continue to play." She says, "You call him back up. You can't play anymore. Take the TV job." So that's how I was fortunate to get in television right away.
Yeah. That's a nice way of talking about the partnership that exists. And obviously you had a really sort of, obviously a very solid foundation. Did you spare yourself a moment to reflect on your career at that point?
No, I don't think there was anything worthy to reflect upon. I played a long time, and I think my baseball career helped me immensely in my broadcasting career, because I was always a backup catcher, and I always had to make the team. And every year I had to work harder and harder and harder to make sure I was on the team. So when I became a broadcaster, obviously as a fledgling broadcaster, I took acting classes, I took speech classes, I took commercial acting classes to be myself, which sounds silly, but my first couple of games, my wife critiqued me and says, "You sound just like Ted Knight on the Mary Tyler Moore Show." Hello, everybody. This is Buck Martinez. So I did all of that, and I worked on my voice and worked on my speech pathology. I had a speech pathologist that helped me understand how to finish your words and how to enunciate and talk. And now, fortunately, I guess for me, everybody recognizes my voice because you never see me on TV. But getting in, I never really thought about playing until in the last 5 or 6 years, when you start to think about you're in the top 1% of the players that play. There's only been 18,000 major league players play in the history of the game. And I played 17 years. I played in the top 1% for a long time for many good teams. So I've been very fortunate. And that's basically what led me to this, because there were so many people that I came across over my years that were Hall of Famers, that were Hall of Fame managers, that I played with Reggie Jackson, I played with Tony Perez, I played with Orlando Cepeda and Tommy Davis, and played for Frank Robinson and Joe Gordon and Bobby Cox and Whitey Herzog. There were so many great people that I didn't appreciate it until you start to sit down and tell stories about what they taught you over the years. But you gather information as you're going about your daily business.
Well, that's one of the great things about the broadcast, you know, feeding those stories in and drawing from that cachet. I want to talk about broadcasting, but I want to go back to talk a little bit about managing. Because you manage the Blue Jays, and I wonder, well, I guess we can tie that to broadcasting. What about that experience lent itself to what you do now?
Well, the managing part of it was really interesting, because they first approached me to manage 3 years before I took the job. Gord Asch was the general manager at the time, and I'm trying to think, it might have been after Cito was let go the first time, and they approached me about managing. And I had just promised my son that I would transfer with him. He was a freshman at Virginia Tech. He wanted to transfer to California and play baseball at a different college. The coach at that college was a friend of mine, so I said, "I will go out there and be a volunteer coach with you in California for the next 3 years." And so when they approached me to manage the Blue Jays, I said, "I can't do it right now. I have to go with my son." So we went to California, and he played baseball for three years. And graduated out there, and that's when they came back and approached me the second time after Fregosi had been let go. Tim Johnson managed, then Fregosi, and then they came to me. At the time, I had a 4-year contract with ESPN. I'd never managed, never coached, never even thought about it. But I was working at ESPN and had just signed a new 4-year contract, and I thought, well, that's good. So the Blue Jays approached me about managing. I said, "Well, I can't manage." I said, "I got a 4-year contract with ESPN." They said, "Well, we'll sign you for 4 years." That really came in handy when they fired me after a year and a half. But what had happened was that Gord Asch was my general manager that hired me. He got fired at the end of the 2001 season. And then, of course, we went through 9/11, and we had all of that change, and then a change in the organization. J.P. Ricciardi came in. We had a meeting in Boston, the start of our working relationship, and he said, "Everybody knows you don't have any discipline and you don't run the team." So I told my wife, "Don't expect to be here long." So I was fired in June.
What did you learn about yourself?
I learned that I had been away from the game too long. It was 14 years since I had left the field, and the game had changed dramatically. You couldn't ask people to do the same things we were asked to do. They just didn't understand it, didn't care to do it. Carlos Delgado asked me one day, he said, "How come we're being punished?" And I said, "How are we punishing him?" "We had to take cutoff from relays today. We had to practice." I said, "Really?" I said, "We're not very good at it, you know." He said, "Well, the Yankees don't do it." I said, "The Yankees have won World Series." But that's the mindset you're dealing with. And it was a different world. That's why I admire the guys that do it now. The Joe Maddens of the world, the Bruce Bochys of the world, Buck Showalters, Joe Girardis, because they get the most out of their players at a time where, like, Joe Madden is incredible what he's done with the Tampa Bay Rays and the Cubs. he's got these multimillionaires dressing up in onesies on road trips, and they don't even know why they're doing it. But he's so good at what he does, he outsmarts them at their own game, and he motivates the hell out of them, and they don't even get it, but they do it.
So in terms of managing versus broadcasting, is your insight as a broadcaster informed more by the psychology of baseball as absorbed through managing, or is it more strategic? Like, what did you pull more in terms of the psychology of the modern ball player that you apply to your view on the game now, as opposed to moving the dials?
My managing for a year and a half changed my whole perception of broadcasting. No question about it. And I have a theory. I call it the dirt theory. The further away you get from the dirt, the easier the game becomes. When you're standing on the field and you understand how it is to play as a player, the game is difficult. It's fast. You have to be quick. You have to react instantaneously. When you go from the field to the dugout, it becomes much slower and it becomes a much easier game. And then when you go from the dugout to the seats as a fan, it really slows down. Now you go up to the broadcast booth and everything is in slow motion. You go, why the hell didn't he make that play? Well, you have to remind yourself when you're down on the field, it's dramatically different. As a manager, when things happen so quickly and you have to make decisions, your preparation is imperative. You have to be informed on every aspect of the game. And now I have an appreciation, having been a former manager as a broadcaster, how difficult it is for him to make a decision. We were talking about Pat, my partner, Pat Tabler, and he is very passionate about the Blue Jays. And the passion doesn't come across on the air like it does in the booth. And John will make a move, and he goes, why the hell are they doing that? In the commercial break. And I'd say, Pat, you don't know the whole story. You know, the guy could be hungover that's not coming in. The guy could have a sick kid at home. The guy could have argument with his wife. You don't know all the stories. I mean, it's not black and white. You got 25 guys that are dealing with 25 spouses and 150 kids. They got a lot of things going on. And that's the great line from Bull Durham. When Kevin Costner goes to the mound and has the meeting on the mound, and the manager comes out, pitching coach comes out, and he goes, what the hell's going on out here? He says, we got a lot of things going on. We got to find a chicken to get this curse off the bat. We don't know whether to get canned Abba for Jimmy's wedding. He said, we got a lot of things going on here. But that's the same kind of thing a manager deals with. You know, you're thinking about the game tomorrow. I mean, everybody in the stands is thinking about that game, that inning, that situation. The manager's thinking about the next week. And I can't use this guy now, or, you know, we get reports every day that Osuna's got a bad arm, he can't come into the game. Well, we're not going to say that over the air, because then the other team knows that. And John will tell us in confidence those situations, but he trusts your judgment to use it properly and appropriately. And so when you fans are throwing beer cans down saying, how come Osuna's not pitching in this game? There's generally a reason for it.
You talk about the game being accelerated at field level, and that's something I don't think many of us fans would know or experience. And because it's faster than it appears, obviously the game, especially over 162 games, requires a certain focus, a rare kind of focus versus other sports, I think, because it has that illusion of slow but it's in fact fast. You must have come across players who had that razor focus that were able to lock in, and those who drifted, and those who didn't quite have that focus, and maybe it was just a traipse in the meadows for them. Can you think of examples of those two extremes?
I can think of 100 examples of those two extremes. I mean, you've all seen the kids that are playing baseball in the outfield. They're picking up daisies and picking weeds, and the game is too slow for them, and they're not paying attention.
You mean at a little league level?
Little league level, yeah. Well, there's some at the big league level that do it too. We've had a couple of those here lately. But when you talk about the guys that have the ability, and we use the phrase slow the game down all the time, where nothing gets them ahead of the situation. There's no panic in anything they do. My roommate was George Brett. He was my roommate in the minor leagues. He was my roommate in the major leagues. He was in my wedding. And he played the game as if he was 15 until he was 40. He had a genuine joy for the game. He loved the game. He loved the challenge. He had a tremendous competitive instinct. But it was fun for him. Robin Yount in Milwaukee was my teammate. Paul Molitor was my teammate in Milwaukee. And those guys just played the game because they loved the game. And they had such a great understanding of the game. And George was so intense. And there were so many things that he could do that nobody else could do. Years ago, when we all learned the game and we would sit around the locker room and have a few beers after the game, we'd sit in the locker room in our uniforms for 2 hours after the game and talk with Hal McCray and Lou Piniella and George Brett and Charlie Lau and Whitey Herzog and just talk about the game. And George would get three or four hits that night and nobody else would get any. And so, how come you got hits and we don't? He said, well, if you see this guy's hand, when he turns his hand like this, I know it's a fastball, but if it's like this a little bit, it's a breaking ball, and I can see that. And they're going, yeah, right. Nobody else can see that. Right. But you're right, it is a focus. A lot of God-given ability physically, and the appreciation and the joy to make sure that you don't get overwhelmed by the situation. And you see guys like Bautista. I mean, he's not had a good year. You couldn't see anything in that ballpark yesterday. The shadows were halfway out to the mound. It was dark, bright contrast. The guy's throwing 99 miles an hour. Eddie struck out before him, and he had no chance. He couldn't see anything, and he was shaking his head like, I can't see anything. And Bautista hits a home run to tie it up just because it wasn't a big deal to him. He was just playing baseball, and he was able to come through and come with that dramatic hit again. But, yeah, there. You know, and we see, like I said, there's been 18,000 people that have played the game. Everybody that gets to Major Leagues is blessed with great talent. What separates the stars from the journeyman players, their ability to focus, to take every game the same way. Derek Jeter doesn't. Mookie Betts doesn't. Xander Bogaerts doesn't. Every single day is the same. And they're going to give you everything they have. And it sounds cliche, but when you go watch those guys play, you're going to get the best they have every day. And that's what George Brett's motto was in his career. At the end of his career, someone asked him, how do you want to be remembered? He said, I want to be at the ballpark, the dad with his 10-year-old kid, take my last at bat, hit a one-hopper to the second baseman, be out by a half a step, and have the dad say, that's the same way you started. Just do things consistently.
Yeah, it calls to mind the Joe DiMaggio line about, he was in his later days and he dove for a ball in center field, and they asked, the coach or manager asked him why he dove for the ball. He says, because there's a chance out there in that stadium, somebody has never seen me play before, right? So trying all the time. I don't want to let you off the hook quite yet. The other side of the ledger, and I, not to pick on him because he's a wonderful ball player, but Tony Fernandez missed the occasional at bat. Right? It might even happen once where his shirt was unbuttoned. He's like, oh, he forgot that it was his turn to bat. Are there players that are able to play the game who, again, don't treat it with that sort of focus and that intensity? Maybe it's free swingers or whatever, but players that go about it a different way yet are somehow able to be successful.
Yes, there are players like that have gifted skills, obviously. I mean, the kid in Washington, Bryce Harper, has tremendous skills. And, you know, you don't see that same intensity day in and day out. And, you know, it's caught up to him. Things have slowed down for him. He hasn't been as productive as he was earlier. And now, Dusty Baker's his manager in Washington. Dusty and I grew up together as kids in Sacramento. And Dusty's been a very successful manager and a very successful player. So, you know, I kind of think that eventually that'll help Bryce Harper. But Harper graduated from junior college as a 17-year-old, and he was on Sports Illustrated as a 15-year-old, and he was marvelously talented. But now, because he didn't have that foundation of working every single day consistently, he's going to have peaks and valleys, and he's going to have some great days when everything just happens to be working, and then bad days when he doesn't know how to get out of it. And that's what Brett and Molitor and Yount and Frank Robinson and Reggie and all those guys could do. They stayed like this all the time. 0 for 20 didn't affect them any more than 15 for 20. They were just going to be the same every day.
Mm. This is the last year for Vin Scully, the famous Dodgers broadcaster. He's one of the few links we have to really that a bygone era of baseball, you know, having seen so much of it over the course of his life. I think on the radio today they were talking about how when Russell Martin was catching for the Dodgers, somebody asked you, you know, what Dodgers catcher does Russell Martin remind you of? And he said, well, let me see. I've seen all of them, so. Like, incredible. And it's true. Maybe I would like to get a word from you about Vin Scully, if possible, and storytelling within the game and within the broadcast. Was that something you had to learn a little bit in terms of when you drop a story, when you maybe take the narrative of the game over to another place and the ability to do that, which he does flawlessly. He's one of the masters. Was that something that you've been conscious of?
Yes, Vin Scully, I believe he's 88, retiring at the end of this year. He started in New York with the Dodgers and went out to L.A. with the Dodgers. But, you know, he had that iconic voice and everybody related him to Dodger baseball, and he's seen it all. And I think his ability to tie the generations together so flawlessly, and he can relate stories, and he has a unique knack for taking an event that happens during a game and relating it to one that might have happened in the 50s and spin it to a point where everybody's interested about it. It's not like somebody saying, well, in the old days it used to be a lot better, but Vin would talk about how they compared and why they're similar and why they're so tied together. But a terrific announcer. I grew up a Giant fan. Okay. I'm still a Giant fan. And we had Russ Hodges and Lon Simmons, who too started in New York with the Giants. And there was a tremendous rivalry, and still is, between the Dodgers and the Giants. So, you know, we didn't hear Vin Scully as much as we heard Lon Simmons and Russ Hodges, but everybody has that affinity. And I know here, a lot of you would have grown up Bernie Harwell fans, listening to the Tigers and Danny Gallivan, listening to Montreal and those great voices that linked a team to that voice. And I think, you know, that's what Vin Scully has, and we'll miss that when he's gone.
Is one of his geniuses in terms of broadcasting pace? Or what is the thing that separates?
I think he links pace to the game better than anybody in the game. Mm-hmm. And that's something that I was reminded early on in my career. I went to work with a gentleman named Harry Coyle, who was the director for This Week in Baseball for 40 years. Wow. And he worked with everybody. He worked with Scully and Graziola and Kubek and Drysdale and Pee Wee Reese, and he worked with everybody. And the one thing he always told me was, if you don't have anything to say, don't talk. Because if you're talking, people will shut you off. But when you're not talking and all of a sudden you say something, they'll scoot to the edge of their seat and listen to what you're saying. Baseball on television is beautiful because it has pictures. And so often during the course of a game, it can be the first inning, the third inning, or the ninth inning, we'll just let the pitchers talk. And you can see what's going on, and you can sense the emotion, and it's more powerful if you see it from a fan's perspective instead of me trying to interrupt it by interpreting what you're seeing. And we had that firsthand in the Cal Ripken game. I announced the game in which Cal Ripken broke Lou Gehrig's record for most consecutive games played. And when he broke the record in the fifth inning, the game became official, we didn't talk for 22 minutes. Not a word. And my partner was Chris Berman. And for him not to talk in 5 minutes is an accomplishment.
Well, it's ironic. That's really considered one of the great moments in sports broadcasting. And it's ironic that it's great because you did nothing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm remembered for two things in my career, as a player for breaking my leg and as a broadcaster for not talking. But we actually won an Emmy Award for that. And it was a great moment, but it was, you know, the producer and director, and nobody said a word. Brooks Robinson was sitting between us when Cal was pushed out of the dugout and ran around the field. And I turned and looked at Brooks, and he had tears in his eyes, and that did me. And I wasn't going to talk about anything till I could collect my thoughts.
Before we get to some questions, I just do want to ask you about the seventh inning. Were you in the ballpark?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I wasn't broadcasting, unfortunately.
Nope. Yep. You probably must think about how it would have gone down. Were you broadcasting? But. You know, they say about baseball, one of the amazing things about the game, one of the reasons to keep watching is you're always going to see something you haven't seen before. And it's remarkable, actually, that a sport can still produce these unprecedented moments. But from your perspective, what was it like to experience that event in baseball history?
It was a decisive game five of the division series against Texas. And it was the seventh inning. Texas had a lead. And if you remember, in the top half of the inning, Russell Martin threw the ball back to the pitcher, and it hit the batter, Sin Shu Chu. And Odor came in from third to score a run. And nobody really knew what it was. Nobody knew. Everybody was like, wait a minute. And I was sitting with Pat, and I'm going, okay, Russell's got to make sure he doesn't hit them. So they called the ball dead, but that's not right. And I literally called umpires. I'd call Richie Garcia. Right out of the, I said, you know, Richie's retired, but I called him up and said, what is this play? And it, as you can see, it took a long time to sort it out. But, you know, Chu was just getting ready. It wasn't intentional or anything. And Russell is responsible for getting the ball back to the pitcher. So now the Blue Jays think they've lost the division series on that play. So now they're down by two runs. And then Texas makes three errors in the bottom of the inning. They couldn't make a play on a bunt. They just couldn't do anything. And then Bautista hits the home run. Well, you know, everybody in the States criticizes him for flipping the bat. But there's not a person that ever played the game that wouldn't have done the same thing after everything that happened in the 57-minute inning. And unless you were in the stadium, you don't really understand how emotional it was. I mean, you know, you peaceful Canadians were throwing beer and shit down on the field. But it was a tremendous, tremendous moment. And, you know, it's been characterized on the Wheaties box, on the NHL hockey guy flipping the hockey stick now, and it's been something.
It really did say something about the importance of this team, I think, to the city, the province, and the country in terms of, you know, that, you know, we all saw what was happening in the stadium, but that was happening in homes and garages and bars all across
Canada. All across the country. We've seen that, and we just saw it recently, of course, in Seattle for 3 days in Seattle, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday afternoon. And I've been doing this for a long time. This is my 50th year in baseball, and I got to tell you, one of the most emotional, satisfying moments I've ever seen as a player or a broadcaster was Monday night when the Canadians sang "Oh Canada" in that ballpark. It was absolutely incredible. There was a choir on the field singing, but the entire stadium was singing "Oh Canada." It was so cool. And the players felt it too, every one of them. It was, you know, there were 35,000 people there, and 25,000 had to be in Blue Jays uniforms. They were covered with Blue Jays gear. It was terrific.
People have talked a little bit about the impact that crowd might have potentially had on the Jays players in that series. You're a player, and you experienced that. Can it affect you when you have that sort of unprecedented support?
Absolutely. Yeah. We have seen it throughout the last couple of years at Rogers Center, how much the crowd gets into and how much it means to a player. And you know, you talk about things you never see. You could go to a game and see something you've never seen before. We had a B delay in Anaheim. 13 minutes, a B delay. And after Bautista hit that home run, I thought we were going to have a curtain call on the road. I mean, he could have come out and tipped his cap to the crowd and the place would have gone bananas. And it's just things you never see.
That's great. Yeah. Well, even last year with the hat trick, right? The hats
coming
out.
Oh, yeah, when Edwin hit the three home runs and they threw the hats on the field. And they did it as well for Donaldson this year. But when Edwin did it last year, and Edwin came back in the dugout and says, why are they throwing those hats?
It's Canadian baseball.
And it was funny. Who explained it to him was Navarro.
Really? Wow. It does call to mind the signs that people made in 1985 in the series against Kansas City. People made signs that said, baseball, the great American pastime with America crossed out and Canadian written under it. So there's this great emerging pride that people have been taking in the game and the team and stuff, and that's really coming to fruition now. Okay, enough of my yapping. So we're going to take some questions from the crowd. Sean, do you know how we just want to go by show by hands, show of hands?
Yeah, I think that's better.
Okay, if you have a question, please put up your hand and we'll you can ask.
We answered all your questions.
Oh, at the back there?
Only because he was a former Blue Jay, but Roger Clemens, does he get into the Hall, in your opinion?
Wow, I didn't know it was going to be that tough a crowd.
No more questions.
Is Roger Clemens going to get into the Hall? When Roger Clemens left Boston, he was basically done as a pitcher. He had been let go because he wasn't throwing hard anymore and he wasn't doing anything to be effective. Dan Duquette was the general manager of the Red Sox at that time and decided to let him go when he came to Toronto. And all of a sudden he became a good pitcher again. And he got big and he got strong and, you know, and he's never admitted to doing anything of the performance-enhancing drugs, but there are not many people in baseball that doubt that he did it. And to be that age and have that much of a turnaround in your career and win two Cy Youngs in back-to-back seasons, it's a little suspect. That's a very difficult subject. We've always had something in the game. Buck O'Neill was the manager of the Kansas City Monarchs. Satchel Paige pitched for the Kansas City Monarchs. And Buck told me personally one day, Satchel Paige came into his office and said, "Buck, I can't pitch today. My shoulder's hurting." And this old-time trainer happened to walk in the room in the middle of that conversation. Said, "What's going on?" And Buck O'Neill said, "Satch said he can't pitch today." Said, "Oh yeah? Come with me." And he pitched a complete game, 9-inning game. And I said, "Buck, what did he do?" He says, "I don't know, but I didn't care." But there's always been something, and always, you know, when I was in the game and when I first got the major leagues in 1969, trainers carried amphetamines in their pocket. And you would feel down or be tired or have a long trip, they'd give you an amphetamine, you'd feel great. And now we found out that wasn't so good for you. You know, and that was probably a genesis from World War II, where a lot of the pilots were given that stuff when they were flying so many flights and everything. We didn't know any better about the science of it, and now we do. But, you know, it's hard to say. There have been more pitchers suspended for PED use than position players. Obviously, there were more pitchers than position players because you have to have 12 of them, but it's a tough time. But I don't think anybody, Pete Rose, Barry Bonds, Pomero, McGuire, any of those people should be included in the Hall of Fame. That's my personal opinion. It's going to be, you know, it's just like baseball. You know, you're going to have everybody arguing different points. I mean, you know, Ty Cobb, everybody raves about what a maniac he was and how bigoted he was and everything else. And here he is in the Hall of Fame. And there's been other people that have had character issues and different problems. But In Pete Rose's case, he was admitted to gambling, and he was gambling on the game. There's no doubt about it. And you know, if you know a gambler, they gamble on everything. They don't just gamble on horses. They're going to gamble on basketball games and baseball games and red games. They're just going to do it. They like the action.
It is definitely, you know, we could have an hour session on that subject alone because it is so complicated. I think what you're saying is it does come down to just your personal opinion, really.
Yes. Who's going to say who's right or wrong? I mean,
right.
Well, you know, we had a tremendous cocaine epidemic in the 80s. And Doc Ellis talks about pitching a game on LSD.
He should be in the Hall of Fame. Right?
Anybody can do that. That's pretty right. Special.
It's true.
Doc Ellis also told his manager one day, he said, "I'm going to hit every one of those Reds that come up to the plate."
Yes.
And he hit 7 of them in a row before they took him out.
The great part of that anecdote, I think, is he hit the first 3 and then he hit Pete, and they were all quite upset. What he hit, and then he hit Pete Rose in the shoulder, and Pete, before he went to ran to first, picked up the ball and rolled it back to Doc on the mound. It's classic.
It was a different era for sure.
Yeah. Other questions?
What's your opinion on the 40-man roster and whether it should, the game changes in September when you're
on? Yeah, you probably heard me say that before, that I think it's wrong. You play 6-month season, the most important month of the season, you have expanded rosters and you're having guys that you don't know anything about determining the outcome of games. And it could be, you know, Tampa Bay bringing up a kid to run the bases. And the Blue Jays did it last year with Pompey. He came up and he had some big stolen bases in the playoffs. He stole four bases in the playoffs, not having an impact in the regular season. But I think they should change it and do it like hockey, where you identify your roster for that given night, 25 players, you have, that's all you can use. But now we had 19 pitchers in a game the other day. And there was a 1-0 game. The Brewers had 9 pitchers they used in a 1-0 game. So, yeah, I don't think you should have the ability to have a 40-man roster in September when the games are so important.
I just wanted you to comment on the excitement of the wild card game, and do you think they should change the format at all?
Yeah, that's the wild card game is obviously it's a one and done. It's Troy Tulowitzki played in a game in Colorado in 2007, game 163. The Rockies and the Padres were tied for the division title. And if you remember the game, it was like a 12-inning game. Matt Holliday slid across home plate with a winning run, and the umpire just stood there. Never made a call, safe or out, but everybody celebrated, and they just won the game. And I asked Troy about that, given the situation. I said, is that the most pressure-packed game you ever played? He says, I think it's always a pressure-packed game. When you lose, you go home. And that's the significance of the wild card game. And I think they straightened out the wild card situation. Having two wild cards, I think, has created this tremendous interest in September. Here we are. Everybody's within 2.5 games. The Yankees are with 2.5 games. The Astros, the Mariners, the Tigers, the Blue Jays, and the Orioles. Everybody's playing for a postseason berth. And the three teams are tied in the National League with the same record. So, yeah, it's and as David Price said, if you don't like the wild card, play better. You know, win the division. And that's the bottom line. If you want to secure a 5-game series, got to win a division.
Do you think it'll come to a point where it's a 2 out of 3?
Only if they shorten the season.
Yeah.
Because we're going to play into November again this year.
And what if you have three teams tied at the end and then you have to have playoffs to
Yeah,
have
I mean, you, yeah, like if this were to begin today, the Cardinals, the Mets, and the Giants are all tied. The first two teams would play a game, and then the loser of that game would go play the third team the next day. So the playoffs would, you know, be delayed even longer. So the best solution to all this is go back to 154 game season.
Is that something you can foresee? Do you think
no.
That, no.
Well, they don't want to give away that gate.
Let's look just quickly. Baseball in 20 years. What do you think the changes, potential changes, would be?
International baseball. Huh. There'll be a team in Tokyo. There'll be a team in London. There'll be a team in Germany, possibly Italy.
Montreal, even.
Yeah. Well, Montreal should have a team right now. If they took the Tampa Bay Rays and put them in Montreal right now, it'd be a gold mine, because they'd be in the East. Montreal fans are used to rooting for the Yankees, the Red Sox. The Blue Jays of Montreal would be a tremendous rivalry. Then you'd have Baltimore. So you'd have all of those six teams in the Northeast. It would be a gold mine. They built a 37,000-seat stadium downtown in Montreal. It'd be great.
Giants, Blue Jays in the World Series. Who do you root for?
The Giants and the Blue Jays. I'm going to root for the Blue Jays.
That's funny.
Really?
Yeah. Willie Mays doesn't play for them anymore. He was my idol. I watched him play for years as a kid. But, yeah, that was like last year, Kansas City and the Blue Jays playing in the playoffs, you know. And I have no loyalties. I had dinner with Mike Babcock and George Brett during the playoffs. And Babcock coached for Brett in Spokane. George owns the Spokane hockey team in the Western Hockey League. And he coached, I think, for 6 years. And George's agent is, George's brother is Bob Babcock's agent. So we had a nice dinner talking about the rivalry of the Blue Jays and the Royals. It was pretty cool.
That's a dinner party I think we'd all like to do.
Oh, well, we were there at the restaurant. Stroman was there, Sanchez was there, Lamarilla was there, Shanahan was there, and we were having dinner with Babcock. Wow. It was a pretty nice night. A lot of stories.
What makes a really great baseball manager really great? What characteristics, what kind of talents, abilities, or what do they have?
You know what, it's changed a lot. And there was a time when Dick Williams and Gene Mock and Billy Martin and those guys were all taskmasters, Ralph Houk and Hank Bauer, all those great tough guys with iron fists and all that. Well, you can't manage people like that in general. nowadays. You have to outsmart them, and you have to think about what motivates them. Tony La Russa was always a terrific manager because he could get into this player's mind, and each individual had to be motivated from a different direction. Whether it was Ricky Henderson or Dave Stewart, it didn't make any difference. He had a method to get the best out of them. That's why I think Joe Maddon is one of the best that we've seen, because every team is different. When he went to Tampa Bay, he didn't do a thing for the first year, just watched his players and kind of called out the ones he didn't think fit. Bobby Cox has done the same thing for years. If you look at the Atlanta roster, guys would go there and play for a year, and then they'd be gone. And they might be great players, but they weren't Bobby Cox's type of players. So you have to have guys that understand the team is first. I mean, it's a very old cliche, but you know, you have to play for the name on the front, not the name on the back of your uniform. But with Joe Maddon, he takes every individual and figures out a way to motivate them. And they brought Dexter Fowler back this spring. Fowler had signed a deal with the Orioles. He had agreed to a deal with the Orioles and then got cold feet, backed out of it. The Cubs signed him. Joe Maddon has a team meeting on the field during spring training and walks out Fowler from the sidelines and reintroduces him to the team as the guy they just signed. But all of those little things he does motivates the players, and it's pretty special. You just have to get into their heads and figure out, you can't fine them, you can't send them to the minor leagues, you can't punish them. You have to make sure they understand how to be a part of a team.
So many different techniques that a manager can use. What about Gibby in terms of his...
Gibby gets a lot of criticism. He doesn't... You don't see a lot of the things he's done, but I think what he's done this year, he's managed the bullpen very well, he's managed the pitching staff very well, and he's managed the older players very well. You know, the Blue Jays are the oldest team in the division, but he's kept Donaldson in the DH spot. You know, Bautista's dealt with injuries all year long. Eddie hasn't missed a game because he's been managed properly between playing first and DH. But the bullpen and the pitching staff, he's done a terrific job with. I mean, nobody expected this Blue Jays team to be near the top of the pitching all year long, and he's done that. And he's just a guy that lets them go about their business. There's a lot of things that, you know, he's even critical of. Guys don't run to first base hard. Guys don't, you know, they hit a routine ground ball, they jog up to first base. Well, now it's become epidemic. You can't change it now. You've let it go on for so long that, you know, it'd be difficult to change. And then if you tell Devin Travis to run, Kevin Pillar, you got to run. Well, Eddie doesn't run, and Jose doesn't run. So it's all about how you set the initial foundation. When you see the Red Sox play, that little bitty guy at second base, he's got a big sledgehammer. And if anybody gets out of place, Dustin Pedroia straightens him out. And that's what sets the tone. And that's when it's the best situation for managers, when a player doesn't. Because then that's where all the pressure comes from.
Do you not think he's given that Russell Martin that responsibility to a point?
Russell Martin? Yeah. Martin has been. Tulowitzki's more now this year than his second year. But they both do it very subtly. They're not cheerleaders, and kind of like the way Jeter did it. Right. Pedroia, he'll scream in your face. He's 5'8", and he's always pointing up to David Ortiz like this.
Jesus. Wouldn't want that job. Any others?
You had highlighted earlier, like, one of the highlights of your career being the national anthem. I wanted to know about, you know, when times are tough in your 50 years, you know, what are some of the things that you leaned on to get you through those slumps? Or, you know, just because baseball seems like, of all of the major sports, that trying harder really doesn't get you a better result. And what's something that you leaned on, or you've seen some of the players in your...
Yeah, one of my early coaches was Charlie Lau, who got most of the recognition for the development of George Brett as a Hall of Fame hitter. And he was a great catching instructor. He taught me how to catch and how to get the most out of a pitcher. But that's what he would use. He would use the phrase, try easier. And it always reminds me that, you know, whatever you're doing, it's not as important or significant or challenging than anybody else's situation, and just enjoy what you're doing. When you think about it, I go to work every day at 3 o'clock, but I go to work every day in a beautiful ballpark watching the best athletes in the world perform.
And Pat and I were talking about it on the plane. Last night, it was the 21st of September, and we got 10 games left. And we said, where'd the time go? Because every day is such a joy to go to work and do these things. And you know what? Every team doesn't have a bunch of guys that are great to deal with. But our job is that we can do our job without having to have great relationships with the players. You know, my 50th year in baseball, I've seen and done everything they've ever thought about doing. And when they say, well, you don't really understand. No, you don't really understand. But, you know, that's the beauty of being in the game so long. I just always go back to how fortunate I am. Like, small town kid, my parents were hardworking people. They both worked for the telephone company. My mom was native Indian, California Indian. My grandparents came from Spain. And here I am. And I'll never forget this. My girlfriend in high school, she was a sophomore. I was a senior. Her dad was this big real estate guy in our little community. He said, you know, son, one of these days you're going to have to give up baseball and do something that can last you your lifetime. I laugh about him all the time.
That's great.
Take one last one?
Sure.
Honest opinion here, do you like the state of baseball as it is right now with the money, the entitlement, the lack of trying right in the first base, the lack of self-motivation?
You know, that's a wonderful question. And when you look at the popularity of the game, it's hard to argue with anything about it. I mean, it has an appeal to so many people worldwide. It's, you know, I went to the World Baseball Classic in Japan in 2013. And the teams from Taiwan and the Netherlands and China and all the fans in Japan were incredibly interested in the World Baseball Classic. The money that's in the game today, and we talk about, you know, we've got three players maybe making $20 million a year. But I believe at this time, the total salaries of the players is at a lower percentage of total revenue than it's been in years. So the owners are still making a lot of money. So there's so much money in the game. There are things I would like to see change. First of all, I'd like to see this stupid slide rule at second base eliminated. Because in a close game, in the eighth inning, you're down by a run. You've got Josh Donaldson at first base. He should have the ability to break up a double play to allow that run to score and tie up the game. And they've taken that away from the game. I also think the slide rule at home plate is ridiculous. If a catcher wants to block the plate and a guy wants to run him over, we've changed the integrity of the game because two people got hurt. And that's not right. I don't like video replay. I think the manager and the coaches in the dugout should say, I want to challenge it. You don't ask some nerd up in the video room who's looking at 9 different angles whether he thinks it's right or wrong. If you think in the dugout that it's wrong, challenge it. But there are so many great things about it. I mean, the talent level is incredible. The bats are harder than they've ever been. And Sean knows about equipment. And the bats are like steel. The balls are harder than they've ever been. And the ballparks are smaller than they've ever been. So even though guys are throwing 98 and 99, the guys can hit them farther than they've ever hit them before. I mean, we got this kid, Aaron Judge, who's hurt right now, but he's 6'7", weighs 275, and he's an outfielder. We got pitchers that are 6'10". It's a big sport now. And just like in hockey, when you see, you know, you got a 6'6 guy standing on skates, he's 4 inches taller than that, and you're trying to shoot a puck past him, good luck with that. But the game is in good hands. I mean, the appeal of the game. What's happened to the game that's really interesting in a television perspective is it's a regional game now. It's not a national game, not a North American game. It's a regional game. The audiences watch their team because of the regional sports networks. They don't watch the game of the week. They don't watch Sunday night baseball. They don't watch Monday night baseball. They watch their team play because they're exposed to more games. When I first started playing, we had a game of the week, one team, that was it. And when the Blue Jays first started, they had maybe 25 games on television. Now every game's on television.
It's interesting, just one final note, if you could address this.
talking about the prosperity of the game. The baseball was worried for many, many years, and they still are, to a point that the fans were dying off, that it wasn't a young person's sport. Yet, you go to Sky Dome, Rogers Center, and you see the crowd. It's become a young fan sport in our city. That's one thing. The second thing is we saw what happened in Toronto, in Seattle with Canadian fans. Well, really all year with Canadian fans going to American ballparks. Did the Jays get enough credit for, it is a national team. It's probably, unlike the, teams in the States, there's fans right across the country. Do the Jays get enough credit in baseball for being the kind of flourishing organization that they are?
No, not at all. When you have a team that can attract people from coast to coast, and I know there's only one team in Canada now, and that has a lot to do with it, but you have created this fan base that and there's a certain amount of pride. I mean, it's a Canadian team. It's our team. We're playing the Americans at their game, and we won two World Series championships, and they don't get the credit for it. But the interesting thing about the crowd in 92 and 93 was a much more corporate-based crowd. There was a lot more corporate suites at Rogers Center then, and there was a lot more corporations that were going, and you saw a lot more suit and ties go to the game. Now it's kids, 25 to 35, young families. They take their kids, and it's a fun. I think one thing they did that was a stroke of genius was they opened up Windows Restaurant and made it to the WestJet flight deck. Because now that's a destination. That's the first place that fills up every night. People go there, grab their beer, go down the rail and scream at the center fielder. It's
imagine
a great
that in 1981. Right?
But yeah, baseball's in a real good spot right now. We are averaging 1 million viewers a night for the whole season. On Sportsnet 1, we've set records. We're probably going to draw 2 million viewers for these games over the weekend. The Yankees, the Red Sox, they draw 250 to 300,000 a night. And we're doing over 1 million every night for the whole year on television. It's pretty incredible.
One of the great Jay's achievements is getting a person from Vancouver to like something from Toronto.
That's right. They're very proud of it, yeah.
It's true.
And everybody that we meet on the road tells us exactly where they're from. For some reason, I don't know if it's a Canadian thing or anything. I'm from Moose Jaw. I'm down here to see the Blue Jays. I go, really? You're dressed up in this and you're in Seattle? You're a Canadian? But they're so genuine and so sincere, and they had a blast on the road. It was great.
Where do you see the Jays finishing in 10 days?
They'll win a wild card berth. There's an outside chance they could catch the Red Sox, but somebody's got to cool the Red Sox off. They've won, what, 8 in a row now? Tillman and Price tonight in Baltimore. Tigers are going to be interesting. Tigers are playing very well right now. They play a doubleheader today against Minnesota. So the Blue Jays' fate's been in their own hands all summer long. They don't have to worry about anybody. All they have to do is win. But they worry about the umpires. They worry about the other pitcher. They worry about everything but winning.
Ladies and gentlemen, Buck Martinez.
Thank you. Great job.
Thanks, buddy. Amazing.